بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين وخاتم النبيين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Welcome again my dear respected brothers and sisters. Inshallah, this is our regular weekly class in تفسير القرآن العظيم. And as you know, we are still in سورة البقرة. May Allah سبحانه وتعالى bless us by learning this great knowledge from the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we, alhamdulillah, we reach ayah number 130. This ayah, as you see it in the screen here, يقول المولى سبحانه وتعالى في محكم التنزيل: ومن يرغب عن ملة إبراهيم إلا من سفه نفسه ولقد اصطفيناه في الدنيا وإنه في الآخرة لمن الصالحين. And who would be averse to a religion of Abraham or Ibrahim except one who makes a fool of himself? And we have chosen him in this world, and indeed he in the hereafter will be among the righteous. Now let's go to the tafsir of this ayah by taking part and part. Let's say, and who would be averse to the religion of Abraham? Now, who, this is, maybe it's a question, which say, who will choose or who will take as a religion or choose or select a religion other than the religion of Ibrahim alayhi salam? And this question is not a question that waiting for answer. This is a question which is in the meaning that there is none, or a wise person will never choose other religion than the religion of Ibrahim عليه السلام. Because the word رغب, أبس رغب عن, يرغب عن or رغب عن. The word رغب means to choose or to wish or you want to get. Called رغبة. رغبة, that's mean need. Okay, رغبة, it's mean need or mean wish or mean something the person want to take or to follow or to achieve. So if it was following by the letter an, which mean choose something else, if it was followed by the fi, raghiba fi, so this is just for you know, for those who are interested to learn Arabic, raghiba fi or raghiba an, they change the meaning. If you said raghiba fi, that means choose it. I say, I want it. It said, أَنَا أَرْغَبُ أَرْغَبُ فِي هَذَا الْكِتَابِ. I want to take this book. أَرْغَبُ عَنْ, that means I need or I want to take something else. So here the ayah said, none is wise, you know, or there is the wise person or the wise people, you know, will never choose or will take a way other than the way or the religion of Ibrahim alayhi salam. This is why Allah Azza wa Jalla said, and who would averse to a religion of Ibrahim? And then answer, and it is religion. In fact, it was mentioned in Arabic millah, and the religion, you know, it's maybe meaning for the word deen, deen. But the word millah, as mentioned in the ayah, وَمَنْ يَرْغَبُ عَنْ مِلَّةِ إِبْرَاهِيمِ. The word millah have different meaning. The millah, okay, here it's mean the religion or the deen of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the next ayah, except one who makes a fool of himself. Only the foolish person, the one who will choose or follow or take as a religion, other religion, other than the religion of Ibrahim alayhi as-salam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we noticed in previous ayat, Allah set Ibrahim alayhi as-salam as imam, as a leader. So all prophets who came after him, they follow his way and his religion. And his religion is Islam. The religion of Ibrahim alayhi as-salam is Islam. And this is what will come, inshallah, with us in the next ayat. So because he submit his will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as you mentioned in previous ayat, that Allah Azza wa Jal said, إِذْ قَالَ لَهُ رَبُّهُ أَسْلِمْ قَالَ أَسْلَمْتُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. You remember the ayat we before, that Allah told him to be submit, and he submitted. طيب. And the word سفيها, إِلَّا مَنْ سَفِيهَ نَفْسَهُ. سَفِيهَ, it means the foolish person, the one who doesn't make the right decision or think in the right way when he make any decision. So this is called سفيه in Arabic. سفيه, the one, is its opposite of wise. It could be, you know, a child. He doesn't know what to choose or what to do. This is the سفه in the mind, in the decision making, in the way the person is thinking. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَلَا تُؤْتُوا السُّفَهَاءَ أَمْوَالَكُمْ. Don't give these people who doesn't know how to deal with their money or the wealth, don't give them your wealth, don't give them your money. Because if you give it to these foolish people, they may waste it. Okay. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying here, إِلَّا مَنْ سَفَى نَفْسَهُ, except the foolish person, the one who doesn't, you know the right from the wrong, the person who doesn't make the right or the correct decision. This is the foolish person who may go astray or choose other religion other than the religion of Ibrahim alayhi as-salam. طيب. The person also, the meaning of safa, it's come as ignorant, as an ignorant person. So as-safi is the ignorant who doesn't know what is the correct from the wrong, or he's the foolish who cannot make the right decision. طيب. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala confirmed this by saying, and we had chosen him, chosen who? Ibrahim alayhi salam, in this world. Why he was chosen? He was chosen as imam, as a leader. And you see, the ayah said, if you look at the Arabic, because you see the Quran is Arabic. So the ayah said, walaqad, walaqad. You see this, you cannot say it in English. They said, and we had. Wa, this is confirming. Okay, this is, it is very confirming a statement, which is mean like swearing. Wa. La, also this is the other letter, which means also confirming. So this ayah, or this statement, was confirmed by swearing, by confirming by three letters. The wa, the la, and the word qad, wa laqad. So this is to confirm this statement that Ibrahim alayhi salam was chosen, you know, by Allah subhanahu وتعالى. نعم. So we know that all prophets were chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala confirming that Ibrahim alayhi salam was chosen to be a leader, to be imam, as mentioned in previous ayat. And he was chosen over all prophets except our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because we know that the best of all prophets, the seal of the prophets, is our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then Ibrahim alaihi salam come next to him. So Ibrahim alaihi salam was chosen over all the prophets, and he was the leaders of all prophets. In fact, all prophets who came after him, they were from his lineage. That means they are from his offspring. That means his children and grandchildren. طيب. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla said, the meaning, and indeed, for sure, and this is also confirming, he in the hereafter will be among the righteous. So he was chosen in both life, in this life and in the next life. In this life was chosen as imam, as leader for all prophets, for all believers. And in the hereafter, he was chosen because he did his duties toward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he did his mission, and he was a good example in every way. And as you know, excuse me, I think I have some calls. So why it said he was chosen here and there in the hereafter he was righteous? Because in this life, as you know, we are in trial. And many people, they may commit mistake. Maybe many people may be influenced by their desires. Maybe they come in a certain point, even they are righteous and believers. In a weak time, they may be influenced by their desire or do something wrong. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that Ibrahim alayhi salam was chosen above all this. So Allah protected him in this world. Allah preserved him in this world. This is why he passed all trials that he went through. The trial of loving his son, Ismail alayhi salam. When Allah commanded him to slaughter him, he didn't hesitate. The trial when he told him to leave your wife, Hagar, and her baby in a desert. And he came and left him, and he left back. And he didn't hesitate. So he was chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he wasn't defeated by any desire. He was not influenced by this world. And in the hereafter, which said, righteous. He was righteous. Why? At the next life, there is no trial. The next life was chosen for only the righteous people. So he was among those righteous who were, chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also in the hereafter to be in Jannah in Paradise. طيب. Let's go now to some lesson that we learned from this ayah. The first one is the truth and wisdom in following the example of Ibrahim alayhi salam. This we learn it from the confirm that Allah Azza wa Jalla said, anyone who follow any way other than the way of Ibrahim alayhi salam is foolish. He didn't choose the right thing for him. And here just I would like to confirm that the religion of Ibrahim alayhi salam is the religion of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So nobody will come and say, you see, we, the Jew, the Christian, and Muslim, all they follow Ibrahim. The only people, in fact, the only people who follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who follow Ibrahim alayhi salam, they are the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You see? So don't be misguided or deceived by the call of what so-called Ibrahimic faith. And they mixing all teaching. And they said, we all follow Ibrahim alayhi salam. The only faith, the only way, the straight path that was followed by Ibrahim alayhi salam was what we are doing now, following Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Also, we learn from this that turning away from the way of Ibrahim is a foolishness and misguidance. So no matter how much this person he thinks that he is wise and he is intelligent, and he say that, well, I'm taking, choosing and think about it, and then he follow other way other than the teaching of Ibrahim and Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, he is not wise. The verse of Ibrahim عليه السلام, Allah Azza wa Jal honor Ibrahim, and this is why he was a leader of prophets before Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. He was a leader. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose him, and this honor was come in three ways. One of this of the first of Ibrahim alayhi salam, that he was imam, he was a leader. Second, that he fulfilled all the requirement for being imam. Third, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make him example for all people who come after him, including our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed in the Quran to our Prophet, which is for us, to follow the religion of Ibrahim alayhi salam, which is the real submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, we learn from this to confirming the hereafter. And we know, as believers, we know that the hereafter is one of the articles of the faith. طيب. Righteousness is a way and description of prophets and their followers. All prophets are righteous. And anyone who follow the footstep of prophet will be righteous. So as-salah, righteousness, is not what we choose or what we do. In fact, it depends on how we do it and at what way we do it. If you do it following the example of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that means you live according to the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi wasallam, then this is the meaning or the right meaning for righteousness. So all prophets, in fact, they are righteous. And anyone who follow them, in fact, they will be righteous. This is why the prophets at the night of Mi'raj, when the Prophet ﷺ was descended to taken to the heaven, and whenever he meet any prophet, previous prophets, they will tell or they will say, welcome our righteous brother and righteous prophet. Six, the one who don't follow the guidance of the prophet is a naive and foolish. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, whoever choose other way other than the religion of Ibrahim, except the one who in fact make fool of himself. So even they are maybe smart, they are intelligent, they may make many discoveries in this world, all their knowledge, in fact, just limited to a physical, to materials, to this world. But when they think about saving themselves, they are foolish because they follow their desire in this world and they don't prepare for the real life, the life that will never end, which is in the next life. The next ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِذْ قَالَ لَهُ رَبُّهُ أَسْلِمْ قال أسلمت لرب العالمين. When his Lord said to him, submit, أسلم, he said, Ibrahim عليه السلام said, I have submitted in Islam to the Lord of the worlds. Now look at the meaning of this ayat. When his Lord said to him, Subhanallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, his Lord, and this is an honor of to Ibrahim alayhi salam, that his Lord. And we know that Allah, the Lord of Ibrahim, the Lord of all prophets, the Lord of the whole world and the universe. But when, as we said, always when was specified for certain place or certain person or certain thing, this in fact as an honor for that which was linked by the world law. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to remind us reminded us about what was the reaction of Ibrahim عليه السلام when Allah عز وجل commanded him to submit, and he submitted. And this is why he was submit, أسلم. And this is the meaning of Islam. The meaning of Islam is the submission to the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the will of Allah azza wa jal, to give up your desire, your life, your belonging, whatever you have, all you give it up for what? For the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you submit your life to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the word submit, he said, submitted to the Lord of the world. Now, the word submit, this including external and internal. Be careful. Because Islam, you remember, we talk about this, Islam include Iman. And Iman include Islam. There are two words. Maybe you are, as a Muslim, you are familiar with this. Islam and Iman. Now, whenever one of them come up, it necessarily include the other one. So when Islam mention, this will include Iman. When Iman mention, this will include Islam. But if they were come up together in one sentence, that mean Islam refers to external act of worship, and Iman refers to the internal acts of worship, which mean the belief, which mean the belief. So this mean that now the person said, I am Muslim, or submit, or aslama, it means that he submitted externally and internally. That's mean in turn, this include his faith, the belief, the acts of worship of the heart, like love, like fear, like hope, all this to submit to the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Externals, whatever come from his mouth, by his action, all should be follow the teaching of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he said the submission to whom? The Lord of the world. Why mention this? Rabbul Alameen. To tell you that the whole world, everything in this world, submit to Allah. Because Allah is the Lord, their Lord, and He is the owner. And this is what Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned. ثم استوى إلى السماء وإن الله سبحانه وتعالى ثم استوى إلى الله عز وجل when he called the heaven and the earth قال ائتيا طوعا أو كرها come willingly or unwillingly قالتا both the heaven and the earth they said what قالتا أتينا طائعين أتينا طائعين we came willingly that means they submitted. So everything in this universe, in fact, is a Muslim. Everything in this world, you know, animals, mountains, plants, all are submitted to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which means everything in this world go according to the law that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it. So when you, as a Muslim, a believer, you submit your will to Allah Azza wa Jal, you submit your will to the one that everything submitted his will to him and follow his command. And there are, Allah Azza wa Jal told Ibrahim alayhi salam, Aslim, be a Muslim. And he says, I submit. But nowadays, you know, and even in previous time, from the time of Adam till now, many people, especially the jinn and the ins. These are the two creations. They were given the option to make a decision to submit or not. But many of them, they didn't submit. You know how much the percentage of those who submit to the will of Allah among mankind? Only 1 out of 1,000. one out of thousand, you know, this is the percentage of those who submitted to the will of Allah Azza wa Jalla. This is why the day of judgment, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will command Adam and said, bring those that will be thrown to the hell. How many they are? 90. In every thousand, 999 will be thrown in the hell, and only one will go to paradise. Look to the percentage. At that time, when prophets, believers, all people, they hear this, they will be scared. It is really frightening that, you know, you have the chance to be one out of 1,000. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us by His mercy at that day. Why those 999 thrown in the hell? Because they didn't accept Islam. They didn't submit their will to Allah Azza wa Jalla. Some of the lessons that we learned from this ayah, my dear brothers and sisters, one of the virtues of Ibrahim that he didn't hesitate to submit to Allah. Allah Azza wa Jalla said to him, submit. He said, I submitted. And he went through different types of trials, which is very difficult, but he passed them all. He didn't hesitate. He wasn't arrogant. He submit and follow the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Confirm that Allah is the Lord of all that exists. This we learn from the statement Rabbul Alameen. Rabbul Alameen. And Al Alameen, from the word Al Alameen, this is plural, and the single is Alam. Wal Alam, noun, from Alama. Alama or Alim, this is a sign. This is a sign, Alama. Why this all exists that called Alama or Alam? Because whatever exists, prove the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He is the one who created everything. Because through this signs, through this alamat, you know that there is God, you know that He is one, you know that He is wise, you know that everything submit to Him. So this is why it's called alam. So everything in this exists in this world called alama. And if you said alam, also translated as world, there is the world of the birds, the world of the animals, the world of the human, and the world of the planet, everything. That even in every type of world, there are many sub-worlds. Now, when you talk about the world of animals, there are the world of elephant, the world of bear, the world of monkeys, the world, and you see in this sub-create, you'll find among how many types of monkeys, how many types of bears, how many types of elephants, subhanAllah. The same thing for human beings and for birds and for plants and all this. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made all this exist, whatever exists, all refers and proof that He is the only true God, subhanahu wa ta'ala. طيب. Submitting should be for the Lord, on the real Lord and the real owner of this universe. You should not submit, you know, to anything else. Because some people, they are, you know, they enslave themselves to something else other than Allah. And therefore, they will be slaves, you know, for one who doesn't own them. Some people, they were enslaved by their desires, maybe by their place, by anything else. But the one who was honored, the one who enslaved himself to the one who created him, to the one who owned him. So Allah Azza wa Jalla owned everything in this world. This is, He is the owner. This is the law, the meaning of the law, the owner. Therefore, the one wise, the wise person is the one who submit to the will of the one who created him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala condemn the disbelievers who make foolish of themselves to go to enslave for themselves for something that never benefited them, like the one who prostrate or worship idols. Can this idol benefit you in anything, help you in anything? Or a people like those who worship Jesus Christ, may Allah be happily peace and blessing over them. You know, this creation, people or idols or birds or anything, they cannot prevent or they cannot save themselves. They cannot defend themselves. How come they can benefit you or defend you? So, subhanallah, Allah Azza wa Jalla said in another ayah, والذين يدعون من دون الله لا يخلقون شيئا وهم يخلقون. Those that you call other than Allah, in fact, they don't create anything. In fact, they were themselves, they were a creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in other ayah, in Surah Al-Nahl, in ayah number 20, also said, أموات غير أحياء وما يشعرون أيان يبعثون. Those that you call, that you submit to them and call them as gods, like idols or people or whatever, they, in fact, they are dead. They are dead and they don't know when they will be resurrected. So how come you go to a saint who is died, who is dead, and call him, you know, when he will listen or answer your prayer if he is dead? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explained in the Quran clearly for us the way of the truth. طيب, the next ayah, وَوَصَّى بِهَا إِبْرَاهِيمُ بَنِيهِ, and here stop, وَيَعْقُوبُ يَا بَنِيَّ إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَى لَكُمُ الدِّينَ فَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. And Abraham instructed his sons to do the same. This means to submit. And so did Yaqub. Yaqub, you know, he's the grandson of Ibrahim alayhi salam, the son of Isaac. Say, it's mean reminding them, oh my sons, indeed Allah has chosen for you this religion, Islam. So do not die except while you are a Muslim, while you are in the state of Islam. And Abraham instructed his son. Here it said instructed, but in fact it said wassa. In other qira'ah, other type of citation said wa'awsa. Awsa or wassa, that means a person when he gives his advice or he is telling his last will at the time of death or right will before he died. So this called wasiyya, called wasiyya or will. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that Ibrahim alayhi salam, he made wasiyah to his offspring about this. Don't forget this religion. Don't forget to submit to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah azza wa jalla reminded us also that even Yaqub, which come after Isa, after Ishaq, alayhi salam, also he did the same. And he told his offspring the same thing. Those who, Yaqub, say, oh my sons, indeed Allah chosen for you this religion. Allah chosen you Islam. So don't die except that you are Muslim. Allah chose for us Islam. Allah commanded us to follow His command. And therefore, the one who follow this, he will be the successful in the hereafter. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding whom? Why Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned this about Yaqub? Because Yaqub, he is Israel. And the children who come with the children of Israel, this is their father who commanded them to follow the religion of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And so prophets who came after Ibrahim, like Musa and Isa alayhi salam, both of them and all other prophets, all of them, they came to renew the teaching of Ibrahim alayhi salam, which to believe in one God and never make any partner or associate anybody with him in his worship. And this is why those great prophets, they reminding their children, even at the last breath of their life, to worship Allah alone, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, some of these lessons that we learn from this, the need to live well. And the well, as we said, that you live, it is wajiba, it is must sometimes, and it is recommended most of the time. It is must if the Muslim, there is debt in his side, he should write it down. So heirs, they will pay it off after he pass away. Or there are some rights that, other people have money for him. So his heirs also, they can request it or look for it. So this is one which is wasiyah. And remember, we study in some hadith, some narrations, the Prophet ﷺ said, it is not for a Muslim to sleep one night or sleep three nights, don't sleep three nights without having your will written, and it will be under your pillow, so your children will find it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all long life in the righteous way. So this to show you the importance, my dear brothers, of well, and the Muslim should take good care, so that even the prophets themselves, they used to take care about it. The point here also, Allah chose the best for his creation, which is Islam. Allah astafa lakum ad-deen. Allah chose this way for you. Therefore, you should not leave it, and you should follow it. And here to show you, my dear brothers and sisters, that in wasiyah, many people, they may care about telling about the money, the wealth, how to divide it, but they forget to remind their children to keep salah on time, reminding them to be righteous, reminding them, to take good care of the knowledge of the deen, to practice their religion, to keep and save their life from deviation. So in wasiyah, it is one of the way of the salaf that when they start their wasiyah, they started by taqwa Allah. So they start the wasiyah by saying, oh, my children, I would like to advise you and remind you that you should be righteous and follow the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ and keep your prayer in time. And then after reminding them of the rights of Allah, then reminding them or telling them about the rights of others. طيب. The need for soft and kind approach addressing when one giving advice. And this, my dear brothers, this is instruction for teachers, for da'iyah, for anyone who would want to give advice. Look to Ya'qub, he said, Ya Baniya, oh my son, oh my son. Same when you advise your brother, it said, oh my brother, oh my beloved brother, okay, oh my good sister. So when you approach people to give them advice, first of all, try to attract their heart, attract their attention. Therefore, they will listen and they will learn from you and will accept from you. One should always remind himself and be ready for his end. This we learned from وَلَا تَمُتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. Don't die except while you are in the state of Islam. So the Muslim, my dear brothers, in this life, we are trying. This is why the ulama said, Al-hayyu la الحي لا تؤمن عليه عنه لا يأمن الفتنة. Anyone who's still alive, we don't know what his end. Be careful about this. Anyone who's alive, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. This is why in every salah, we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to protect us from fitnat al-mahya wa fitnat al-mamat. The trial or the fitna of this life. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us on the straight path till the last breath of our life and make our the last word that we say before we get out of exit of this life. La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasul. طيب. Deed depends on its final point. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فلا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. So this is already we discussed and talk about. The next ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, أم كنتم شهداء إذ حضر يعقوب الموت إذ قال لبنيه ما تعبدون من بعدي قالوا نعبد إلهك وإله آبائك إبراهيم وإسماعيل وإسحاق إلها واحدا ونحن له عابدون. Or were you witness when death approached Jacob, يعقوب, when he said to his sons at the time of his death, what will you worship after me? He asking them. They said, we will worship your God and the God of your fathers, Ibrahim, Ismail, and Ishaq. One God to confirm. And we are Muslim to him. We are submitted to him. Now look at this ayat. Or were you? Who are these that the Quran addressed them? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is here addressing the Jew at the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Asking them, or were you witness? Are you there when Yaqub addressed on the time of Yaqub was dying? You were there to know what he said? This question is not question that waiting for answer. This question means that you were not there. Now, how come you claim, you or Christian now, you claim that you are following the teaching of Ibrahim alayhi salam? And you say that what you are doing fit what Ibrahim alayhi salam and Yaqub and Ismail doing or did. So this is inkar. So then you claim that you are following them. But you don't even, you wasn't there and you don't remember the well that Ibrahim alayhi salam and Yaqub left for his children. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanded, you know, his prophet to remind them that in fact you are not following the well that Ibrahim alayhi salam and Yaqub they left for their children. When he said to his son, you are not there. When they son. And what he said to them, you remember the previous ayah. What will you worship after me? So even at the time of death, Yaqub alayhi salam, when he felt that death is approaching him, he wanted to make sure to confirm the truth and to confirm to his children to keep in the straight path by saying, asking this question, what will you worship after me? To listen and to hear this answer from them. So they say to him, what? We will worship your God. And who is this God? They confirm it again. A God of your fathers. Who are they? Ibrahim, Ismail, and Ishaq. Ibrahim is their father because he's the father of Jacob. He's the grandfather for Jacob and the grandfather like the father. How about Ismail? Ismail, in fact, his uncle. Their uncles, because Ibrahim alayhi salam was the brother of Isaac, of Ishaq, عن يعقوب جيكوب is the son of إسحاق. So in fact, إسماعيل is the uncle of Jacob, which means he's the uncle of his children. But he was called, they call him what? As their father. And from this, we learn that the uncle, which means the brother of the father, like the father. Like the father, same like the father. طيب. And then, the ayah said, one God, confirming the oneness of Allah. And then confirm again by saying, and we are Muslim to him alone. We submit to him alone. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding the Jew at the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that you are not following even the will of Ibrahim alayhi salam or the will of Jacob, Israel, your father, that you are the children of Israel, you consider yourself the children of Israel. But even you are saying that you are children of Israel, you don't follow, you don't fulfill, you don't, you know, submit to the will of Allah by worshiping him alone, according to the will that he left for you and the advice that he commanded your forefather. So we learn from this that all prophets care about Tawheed. All prophets, my dear brothers and sisters, call to the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because the religion of Allah is one. Based on what? Believing in the one true God. The creator Allah Azza wa Jalla subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why Allah Azza wa Jalla said in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ. Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned in the Quran that he sent in every community, in every community that worship only Allah alone. طيب. Also we learn from this that all prophets same like other human beings. Therefore they will die. And therefore, how come you worship somebody who will die? Isa alayhi salam will die. All prophets die. The only one who doesn't die is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So all human, you know, all prophets are human. The permissibility of telling one's will at death time, as long as the person is aware of what he or she said. You know, because some people, they said, well, we cannot take the word from this person. He is dying. This depends, you see. We know that the wish, I mean the will, should be written before the person reached this point. But if the person is aware and his mind and his, you know, thinking that you know what he is saying, then his word will be taken. But if at that minute he was not knowing what he's saying, it will not be taken. This depends on their circumstances. But according to this, it could be taken جواز الوصية and the حضور الأجل. نعم. The grandfather is same like the father, as we mentioned. And why we are saying this? Because we learn from this, and when we are talking about inheritance, the law of inheritance, in the law of inheritance, the grandfather will take the place of the father. For example, if the father was dead and the grandson later passed away, one of his heirs is not his father because his father has already passed away before him, then the grandfather will take his place. Therefore, the brothers, they may not get anything. Anyway, this is in the detail of the law of inheritance, but to show you that the father will take the role of the father if the father is absent. Now, the brother of the father, the uncle, also could be called father, as they said about Ismail alayhi salam, and he's not their father. طيب. The children of Yaqub alayhi salam, the children of Yaqub were believing in Tawheed. That means the children of Israel. And who are they? You know, Joseph, Daniel, and the other 10, they are 12 children. And from among these 12 came the tribes of the children of Israel. All of them, all those 12 sons of Yaqub, of Israel, they were believers. They believe in one God. They were Muslim. So those who say they claim that they are following their way, they are not truthful, because in fact they deviated. If they kept the will of Yaqub alayhi salam, then they should follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because he is teaching the same message and the same deen. The importance of teaching sincerity and faith. This was mentioned, وَنَحْنُ لَهُ مُخْلِصُونَ, and we are sincerely for him, as is mentioned in the ayah. وَنَحْنُ لَهُ مُسْلِمُونَ. طيب. Confirming that, the importance of tawheed, I think this is was, yeah, the same, sincerity. And confirming the tawheed of Allah, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. طيب. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, تِلْكَ أُمَّةٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ لَهَا مَا كَسَبَتْ وَلَكُمْ مَا كَسَبْتُمْ وَلَا تُسْأَلُونَ عَمَّا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. That was a community. In fact, that was a nation, people, that had already gone before. For them is what they earned, and for you is what you have earned. And you will not be accountable for what they have done. That was a community or nation or people that had already gone. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Tilka ummah. And the word ummah, in fact, in Arabic, it could be a nation, group of people. It could be a period of time. And it could be a leader. As Allah Azza wa Jalla said about Ibrahim alayhi salam, kana ummata. In Ibrahim kana ummatan. He was ummah. He was a leader. So these three meaning for the word ummah, and we understand which one is the correct meaning based on the context of the sentences. So here it said, those are group of people. That means the people the time of Jacob and his the 12 sons of Israel. All these, they already gone. They lived in certain time and they passed away. You will not be questioned about them. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, for them is what they are. They already lived their time. They did what they did. And they have what they are, if good deeds. And for you is what you have earned. So what they did for them, and what you do is for you. You will not be questioned about what they did. So don't depend on what they did. And they say they were righteous and we are their children, therefore we'll join them in paradise. There's no guarantee, because everybody will be accountable for himself. Everybody should strive to save himself, not depending on the achievement of his previous father, no matter who are they. And you know, there are many different stories in the Quran, you see, that tell us that no one will save anybody else. Everyone, by the will and the mercy of Allah, will be saved through the good deed that he do. You know, the son of Noah, he was among the disbelievers. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him that he is not of you. He's not following you. The wife of Lot, the wife of Noah, both their husbands were righteous prophets. But the day of judgment, they will be in the hell. So everybody will be responsible about his own. And you will not be accountable for what you have done. And this is the justice of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Everybody is accountable for his own deeds. As Allah Azza wa Jalla said, وَلَا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةٌ وِزْرَ أُخْرَى. No soul will be accountable for the burden of others or other souls. الله عز وجل سيد إن هذه الآية، والآن ليس للإنسان إلا ما سعى. And man will not get except what he achieved for himself. Okay, the lesson that we learn from this ayah also, one should not depend on what one's father did or gained. If your father is a prophet, as the Jew claim, for example, if your father is a priest or imam or sheikh or good person, this will not benefit you at the day of judgment. What benefits you is your action. This is why the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he was in Mecca, he was calling on his family and his tribe, to telling them that I cannot benefit you at the day of judgment. When he said, وَيَا فَاطِمَ بِنْتُ مُحَمَّدٍ إِنِّي لَا أُغْنِي عَنْكِ مِنَ اللَّهِ شَيْئًا. Oh, Fatima, my daughter, at the day of judgment, I will not be able to help you. So this means you help yourself by following the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not to get in an argument about what happened in previous time. Whatever happened in the past has happened. So don't go and make argument about it and discussion. And this advice, my dear brothers, because there are some Muslims, unfortunately, they go and dig in history and they try to talk about what happened at the time of the Sahaba. You know, there was fitna. There was some fighting between some of the companions of the Prophet. And everybody has his own view at that time. We will not be questioned about that dispute. Therefore, don't, you know, get yourself involved in this argument. That will not benefit you. Allah Azza wa Jalla will judge among His creation the day of judgment. He will not be responsible about them. And also, with anybody who passed away, we should not care about what he did, right or wrong, because Allah Azza wa Jalla is the one who will judge him. Now, number three, everyone is responsible for what he did, and it's very clear. The later will not be questioned about the one previously. Will not be questioned about the one ahead of you. But the first could be questioned about the later. Why? Because maybe this group in the past, they are the group or the individuals who misguided people after them. You know, like, for example, now deviations. You know, some sects who deviated from the straight path. Those leaders, there will be questions about what they did and about whatever people who follow them or they were misguided by them. وَلْيَحْمِلُوا أَوْزَارَهُمْ وَأَوْزَارَ الَّذِينَ They will carry, they will be accountable for their own sins and for the sins of those who follow them and for their misguidance. This is what the Prophet ﷺ said, مَنْ دَلَّ عَلَى هُدَى فَلَهُ مِنَ الْأَجْرِ كَمِثْلِ مَنْ تَبِعَ The one who guide people to guidance, teach people, and then they follow him, he will be rewarded for his teaching. And whoever acts and learn from this knowledge will be, you know, rewarded. And this reward also will be go again to the one who guided them. And on the other side, they will, you know, they will get their own sins for their deviation. And this sins also will be thrown on the back of the one whom is guided. Then may Allah save us from this misguidance. طيب. I think this is the one that I was mean. طيب. Number five, confirming that everyone will be questioned about what he did and that he will be accountable about it. And this to show you the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The next and the last ayah, وَقَالُوا كُونُوا هُودًا أَوْ نَصَارَى تَهْتَدُوا قُلْ بَلْ مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ حَنِيفًا وَمَا كَانَ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ They, that's when the Jew and Christian, they said, follow our way and rightly, and will be guided. Say, O Prophet, say Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no, we follow the faith of Ibrahim alayhi salam, the upright, who was not polytheist. طيب. They, وقالوا, they, this referred to the Jew. But it doesn't mean the Jew and the, you know, the Christian joined together. The Jew saying, follow our way. We are in the right, on the right straight path. The Christian, they say, no, don't follow the Jew, follow our way. Follow Jesus Christ. We are in the straight path. We are following Ibrahim. So every one of them, the Jew and Christian, claim that he is in the religion of Ibrahim alayhi as-salam. And then the answer came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm sorry, I didn't mention, yeah. The Jew and Christian say, say to them, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no, we follow the faith of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Which means that you, Jew or Christian, you don't follow the way of Ibrahim alayhi salam. You don't follow his way because his way is the oneness of Allah Azza wa Jal. The way of Ibrahim alayhi salam is the Islam as was mentioned when Allah said to him, Aslim, he said, Aslamtu lillahi rabbil alameen. I submit to the will of Allah. The upright, that means the straight. The straight. He was not deviated to the left or the right. Or in the other meaning, al-hanif. The hanif, the word hanif means which is go aside. Okay? But if it was the community was bad, or they, all of them are disbelievers, and you violated them to the truth, that means you turn to the straight path. So this is what does it mean when said Hanifa? That means he left their misguided way and follow the straight path of Allah, which is Islam, and he was not among those who are polytheists. طيب, we finish by this lesson that we learned from this last ayah. Deviated people always call people to their false way and misguidance. This is what they do. The Christian everywhere, they have missionaries, you know, to misguide people, try to misguide Muslim, and they're telling them that there is no way for salvation except that you follow our way. And this is deviation. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And, you know, even among Muslims, there are some sects, you know, like the Quranic group, who they want to misguide Muslim, like those Qadiani, you see, like the Baha'i faith, all of them, they deviated and they call people to their deviation. May Allah protect us from this. Anyone who misguides people is following the example of the Jew Christian. Anyone. Why? Because they are, this is, they set the example of misguiding people. The truth and straight path is one. There's only one way to Allah Azza wa Jal. Don't be misguided by saying, you know, some people, they say now we have, you know, follow Abrahamic faith. If you follow Christianity or Judaism or Islam, you are still on the Abrahamic faith. That's wrong. Because the Abrahamic faith is the religion of Islam, and this is the only one that follow now by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his followers. So the Jew and Christian, in fact, they are not following Ibrahim alayhi salam, and Allah commanded us to follow the religion of Ibrahim, which is Islam. Ibrahim alayhi salam was praised and honored, you know, in different way for different reasons. First of all, he was an imam and leader, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, mentioned in ayat that we mentioned. لِلنَّاسِ إِمَامًا. I will make you as a leader for mankind. And also he was in the straight path. So he was praised by Allah that he never deviated. And also he was praised that he was sincere in worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was mukhlas. And we learn from this, as you see it here, the three points that I mentioned. Judaism and Christianity, now, in fact, they are types of shirk. They are not, you know, they call themselves, for example, now, we are of the a religion of one God. And that's not true, because the Christian believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, or they worship him beside God or the Holy Spirit. The Jew, they say about Ezra that he is the Son of God. So the only group who worship the oneness of God, believe in the oneness of God, are those the follower of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And I think we by this we finish, alhamdulillah, our class. We'll leave some time for your question if you have any question. Barakallah feekum. May Allah benefit us all from what we say. Naam. Naam. Yes. Yes, Alish. Go ahead.
السلام عليكم شيخ.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
شيخ, my question is about inheritance.
Yes.
Yeah, because we are always hearing once the father is gone, يعني he will leave his inheritance to his children. How about the mother, the woman, if it happens she is rich and she wants to leave some inheritance or her wealth, her money to her children? Is it okay?
No. You see, the inheritance in Islam, Allah Azza wa Jal made fixed share for the heirs of the person, the legal heirs, okay? A fixed share. Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned very clearly in the Quran, the share of the son, the share of the daughter, the share of the wife, the share of the husband, the share of the father or the mother or grandfather. All are mentioned clearly in the Quran. وَلَا وَصِيَّةَ الْوَارِثِ. Therefore, it is not right to make a will for the one who already have fixed share. The will, I mean, that's mean the person, maybe he write a will to give portion of his wealth after his death for someone that he is not among the legal heirs that they will have fixed share according to the Sharia. So it's not for the mother to say that all what I have will be to giving to my son or my second son or the sons. I mean, the children, they will give their fixed share as it was prescribed in the Sharia and in the Islamic law of inheritance. Now. Okay.
جزاك الله خيرا يا شيخ.
أيها. Another question related to our class, please. Okay. Any question in the chatting box, sister?
Yes, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Yeah, let me read first this one. Dr. Yahya, why Surah Al-Baqarah named or heading Al-Baqarah, which means the cow, when it's all about the Prophet Ibrahim, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Isaac, Ismail, Jacob, and etc. Peace be upon all of them, and his lesson. Like for example, in Surah Maryam, it's all about the life of Maryam. Peace be upon her. So this is her questions, Dr. Yahya.
Yes, Al-Baqarah, my dear sister. In fact, the name of the surah, it's not because of the person or the life of the person, you know. Allah, you see that the names of the surah, it depends, usually it takes one point, like a story or incident or a person or unique something, and then the title or the name of the surah was given about this. This name, the Surah Al-Baqarah, it was mentioned about the story of Al-Baqarah because this is the deep meaning, in fact. If you notice in this surah, all and mostly, in fact, talk about the children of Israel. And the children of Israel, they were given many signs, okay, and many miracles. And one of them, which is famous, is the cow, which was, you know, slaughtered. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make a person resurrected another person, the victim, to tell who was his killer. This is one point. Also, the story of Al-Baqarah, if you know, as you notice, they before they slaughter the cow, they ask many questions. What is the color of the cow? What is the age of this cow? To show you the stubborn mentality of these people, they don't follow the command of Allah directly. They always, they hesitate, they make many questions. So, you know, they follow their desires. So the cow here, it is as a, like a symbol of the arrogance people, those people, stubborn people, they don't follow the command from the first, you know, the first point or the first word. So there's no connection between the name of the surah and the life of the person was mentioned in the surah, because every surah, it has subject or certain topic mostly go around. And here is talk, as we said, remember when we explain about Surah Al-Fatiha, at the end Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, غَيْرُ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِينَ. And then Surah Al-Baqarah talking about الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ, the stubborn people of the children of Israel, you know, and as you mentioned, almost one third now of the surah that we covered, almost talking about how stubborn are these people. And it was very clearly shown when they make the argument about the cow that they were commanded to slaughter. I hope this is clear now.
Assalamu alaikum.
Okay, so yes, Amina, go ahead, sister.
Brother, I'm aware of there is no obedience to creation in disobedience to creator. I would like to know the women's position when they are under the men, who are lesser aware of the religion than them. I would like to draw on your experience. I know relevant ayahs, but I would like to draw from your experience to deal with this issue. Like, we read the Quran more instance for some women, me and my friends or whoever, and we are faced with the men in the family who are less knowledgeable of the Quran. So we get stuck sometimes as to how to deal with respect and obedience to our elders and as father or husband or brother or anybody. Sheikh, if you have any answer on this.
Well, my dear sister, we know that, alhamdulillah, the Muslim find in the teaching of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam every answer, and the etiquette and the way how to deal with everyone. Like, for example, the ayat we mentioned now about when the children of Yaqub, they said to their father when he was giving them advice, what did he say? They said to him, your fathers, and then they mentioned the name, even including their uncle. So Islam teach us to have respect for the elderly and have the mercy to the younger. This is the way of the Muslim. The Muslim, when he deal with somebody who is younger than him, he will deal with him in very merciful way, very kind way, very soft approach. When he deal with somebody who is older than him, he should show respect to him. Anyway, so this is very, very wide subject when how to deal with people. But I'm sure the Muslim, if he study the seerah, the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he will find the example, how did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam dealt in every situation. So my advice for anyone who want to learn akhlaq, he should study the character of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and see how he deal in different situation. Nah.
Okay, we have another question, Dr. Yahya. When the Quran was
Huh?
revealed, it is also revealed by the name of the surah?
Say it again, sister.
She's asking, when the Quran was revealed, is it also revealed by the name of the surah?
The names of the surah, this is the other topic. We're talking about the ulum al-Quran, the science of the Quran. And remember, we made very quick introduction before we start this series of classes. And the names of the surah, some ulama, they said it is tawqifiyya. That means it was given by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So when surah was mentioned, he will say this will be Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah Al-Tawbah. Therefore, sometimes for one surah, there are sometimes more than one name. Like, for example, Surah Al-Isra, it's called also Surah Banu Israel. So sometimes the surah has more than one name. All this was mentioned by the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Naam.
Another one, Dr. Yahya, regarding the inheritance. What if a parents are not Muslim and their kids are embrace Islam? Are they allowed to accept inheritance?
This is an area of discussion. So I don't like to get into this subject because it's not related to our topic. But generally, the general concept that Muslim doesn't inherit from non-Muslim, and the opposite is also the same thing, that a Muslim doesn't inherit from a Muslim. But some ulama, some scholars, they see that it is okay for the Muslim children to inherit from their non-Muslim parents. So this is an area of discussion and argument among ulama. I cannot give a very stated answer on this. It's need maybe some other time to explain it. Nah.
That's all, Dr. Yahya. Thank you very much.
Okay, jazakumullah khair. Thank you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all and bless us our knowledge. And inshallah, we'll meet tomorrow as we do always at 7, inshallah, p.m. for our fiqh class. Jazakumullah khair. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.